everyone. I'm going to talk about beyond mobile, the future of HTML5 games, along with my colleague, Raheel, Yawar, and Casilda, Zulueta. She's a game developer and a game artist at Friendship Studios, as she introduced us. Friendship Studios is a company founded in Cologne, Germany, 5 years ago. And in this time, we developed over 150 games, HTML5 cross-platform based. We worked with over 50 IPs, and we are a diverse team of over 17 people by now. And why HTML5? You say there is no porting needed. The quality is nowadays comparable to native mobile. It is real cross-platform. You can compile once and run everywhere. It works not only on web browsers, regardless of it being mobile or desktop, but it's also available for messenger apps like Facebook Instant, WeChat, and Line.
All right, so before we really get into it, I want to talk about Flash, because this is where web games actually were born. And that was a very nice era. We had lightweight games that were low on the browser, no download needed. And we had some very fun 2D games, and the platform was really approachable for everyone, whether you were a game developer or just tinkering with it. But of course, that wasn't really the end of that. Over time, we went and saw the demise of Flash, which was very necessary. And that fortunately gave rise to a lot of new technologies. The first one of which was hardware acceleration for mobile browsers. So that was back in 2010 when Firefox and Internet Explorer launched hardware acceleration. Then in 2011, WebGL was launched, and then a year later, libraries like XCJS gave us power to make sprite manipulations. So you could use Canvas or WebGL using these libraries just to render your sprites on hardware and not on software, which was already a great step in the right direction. Then that led into 2D games for HTML5 platform, and that gave us Phaser, which is arguably one of the most popular 2D libraries that work on WebGL and lets you make 2D applications. And it gave you what XCJS gave you, because it was based on that earlier, and that's manipulating sprites and running those on your hardware, on your GPU. But on top of that, it also gave you physics libraries embedded into it, and audio library, and it let you play around with particle effects. Then third-party tools got involved as well, and I give you one example of Tile that lets you make levels, and it lets you make modular levels and also isometric levels, and it was pretty popular and was the go-to library to use for the go-to platform to use for Unity and then Unity came up with their own tile-based editor, and it jumped into this race and gave us a JSON exporter, and that let us make awesome levels. And this is an example of the Barbie jump and run that we made, and we used this tool to make our modular levels that were put together to create a bunch of levels for the puzzle game.
Other existing tools to support the Phaser engine are the ones for static animations. We use Dragon Balls because it's free, it's open source. But where do I go with it? Sorry, wrong button. You can also use Spine Sprite, you maybe know them as well. Adobe Animate, which used to be the Flash animation tool. It consists of puppet-like and native form animations. You just have to import the limbs of a character, rig them to bones, animate in a timeline with keyframes, and then export these limbs. So we have our own 2D pipeline of Flash Shift, and how does this work? The artist creates the assets in Photoshop, exports them, gives them to the developer, they implement it in Phaser, then makes a build, puts it on the web, you can play in any browser, right? Alternatively, a level designer will make levels in the entire web editor, or an animator will make animations in Dragon Balls in our case. but the UI at this point is at the hands of the developer, and that is prone to design bugs, right? So we came up with an in-house tool that is called Lambda. It is a UI editor that just gives the designers it puts in the designer's hands the layout design, so that removes the design bugs, or the majority of the design bugs, and you no longer have to make manually changes with CSS. The Lambda user interface is very simple. On the bottom left, you have your resources, so all of the source files that you exported. Above, you have the project folders. They are divided into categories, like the atlases for the images, and the phones, the buttons, and you have the layouts. If you open the buttons or the layouts, you have on the right part, yes, on the right part, the properties of the object you are selecting, or of the overall file, and below, a list of the assets that are embedded, right? Lambda is made built in Electron. We were going to make it as a plugin for Photoshop, but the code was so complicated that it was easier to make an in-house standalone tool, basically. Lambda is also used for 3D level editor and particle effects 3D editor.
All right, so we have been mostly talking about 2D games, but now I'm going to step into the 3D platforms. So we use WebGL, which is a library that is made, which is a hardware abstraction called WebGL, and we use Blender for our asset creation and animation creation. And all of the games that you see here were made using a combination of WebGL and Visual. And while we're talking about that, I just want to mention that WebGL has other alternatives as well. So WebGL and Play Canvas are also made on top of WebGL, and they let you do the same things. Babylon was made by two developers from Microsoft. Play Canvas gives you a lot more options compared to the other libraries, but it is not free. But anyway, we went with WebGL, and that's what I'm going to talk about from now on. So the great thing is that it uses WebGL, which has kind of the same rendering pipeline as OpenGL, since it's based on that, and that lets us make GSS SL shaders, and that run really fast since everything is running on hardware. And we don't have node-based editors for shaders yet, but yet you can write GSL code, which is already a very nice step.
Some experts mishaps though. As a general rule, you have to try often and fail fast. We used a previous JSON exporter for Blender, but it required different setups for each type of exports, usually like the animated skin meshes or the static meshes collections. But now with the GLTF exporter that we implemented now in the workflow, and it's the tool that is behind the Lambda 3D pipeline, we removed as well what we call nightmare dragons. That's this one. That's very useful. So, in order to avoid that stuff, yes, we have to think of 3D constraints. The polygons is very important, especially if we're working for mobile. We are aiming for something that resembles the Casilda 1 era numbers. Of course, static meshes are cheaper than skin meshes. A skin mesh will take like 10 times the effort. It will be 10 times more expensive to run, right? There is also a limited amount of bones. Some devices beyond 17 bones just won't render your character. And there is no inverse kinematics, so the animators have to make forward animations, forward kinematic animations for the game, which is in itself a challenge, I have to say. This is an example of an export. This was our previous tool for previewing our skin meshes with a list of all the actions exported in Blender. So, the 3D pipeline is similar to the one from the 2D. We have we make the meshes, we map the dimensions in Blender, we export previously the JSON, files, we make the textures in Photoshop, we implement them in Lambda, we implement the environments in Lambda so we can make the levels in there. We can preview the animations in there as well, so the dev doesn't have to make a video for us to see them. We make the particle effects, then the developer implements everything in the 3GS library and in Phaser for the UI elements, then makes a build, puts it on the web to play in any browser. By now, the 3GS has its own editor, which is in essence. All the applications that Lambda has, but on top of it, we added this UI management and implementation in Phaser, which is unique to our tool, our pipelines. To give you an example of what HTML5 is capable of, we have Knights of Fortune, which is the first project that uses all of our in-house tools. It's also the first one that we use with the slices and meshes, so we can change the equipment in different pieces from our heroes. You can play the demo online right now. And as you can see, this is an example of first-time UI, so it was made with the UI editor in Lambda. And then an in-game, which has already particle effects, and the skin meshes, playing the animations, environment, etc. Also, we call it some shader you need to have a special technique look.
So another case in point of the seriousness of the HTML5 platform, we have made multiple real-time multiplayer games, but we have used our own proprietary multiplayer server, which uses Golang as the base, and it lets you write JavaScript and Discord, because most of the code that we write is in JavaScript, and for better or for worse, the front end of web is in JavaScript. So now probably the most important part of the presentation, because I will be surprised if you don't have this question already. So why not use Unity when it also gives you an exposure for HTML5 platform? And to answer that question, what I did was I used a partial scene of one of our games called Casilda Surfer, and I made it once in our own engine, and then I made it in Unity, and I compared the two. So first off, the build size for the HTML5 libraries is really small. This had an export of 3 MB, and for Unity, it had an export of 10 MB. And that's a problem because Unity bundles a lot of its own library files inside the build. It's usually large, and that's not really that great for us, because since this needs to be downloaded from a website, users should not be discouraged by the long loading times or by the loading times, which would mean that you are basically spending your data volume to download a game. Then another thing that's important is we use JavaScript, like I said, to develop the game. We need to work in C#, and C# is the faster programming language when it comes to processing times. But advantage that HTML5 has is you can use any open source JavaScript-based library with a package manager without problems. But if you have to do the same with Unity, you have to define the API, and you have to build the application, and then you will finally be able to use it. It's just extra steps, and it's highly inconvenient. The build times are pretty much the same. Unity has come a long way, but usually the HTML5 build times are still faster. The deal breaker, however, for us was that Unity does not support mobile browsers. It only supports desktop browsers. And our engine, on the other hand, you can make a build and run the same game on multiple devices without problems. And Unity, since it's focusing more on AAA sort of features, still would need some time for it to catch up and release a good HTML5 update again. Just some upper talks or some other advantages are that you can make interactive ads using the HTML5 platform. So you can make, even if your own game was made in a mainstream engine, you can just replicate a couple of features or levels and make that one on Google Ads. So that's awesome because the player can actually get a glimpse of what your game is like. And if you want to port it, so it runs on the desktop browser, but if you want to port it to, let's say, Google Play or App Store, you can still do that using a particular over of Chromium. So that about does it. I hope this gives you a bit of an insight of where the HTML5 platform is right now. It definitely has come a long way since the days of Flash. And I hope it gave you a bit of insight of how you can use HTML5 in your own production pipeline for your own projects. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We have a couple of minutes for questions. Anyone?
Your burning needs for HTML5. All of the answers now.
No? Nothing? Do you have anything you'd like to expand on? Have
extra
couple of minutes.
So if you do think of a question, we will hang out back there, so you can come to us. And I know there is like a general preference towards using mainstream engines. So one of the things that I would mention is that we showed you our proprietary tools, and then we also showed you free alternatives. And to set up, takes a bit of time. Unity, you just run an application and you have the level editor there and everything is there. In the HTML5 platform, there is, like, you can use Play Canvas, which isn't free, but gives you the same sort of power. If you want to set something up on your own, you need a little bit more boilerplate code. Once you have that running, then you can just reuse that for your single project. In general, for performance and for the ease of deploying stuff on mobile and then comparison with how native mobile works and how HTML5 works on browsers, I think there is a strong solid comparison. So I would say again that it's a really important platform and would be in the future.
Actually, I have a question. So because we are a conference that is very much about mobile and monetization, so can you expand a little bit on, like, how does monetization work in HTML5? Are there ready-made solutions, or what do you have to do to get some of that
sweet
customer money into your own pocket?
Yeah, so the great thing is that whenever any monetization solution comes up, they usually make it on the web. So an SDK for JavaScript is usually the first thing that they would make anyway if they even don't advertise it. So you have that covered always, basically.
Cool. What do you use yourself?
So we usually publish for our clients that we have monetization set up for themselves. So they have their own API that we implement our own game. So it's also proprietary that you won't really find in the market.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay. So thank you. So let's give a big round.